Okay, good morning, folks.
Good morning.
Thanks, Claire. Good to be all very enthusiastic. Thank you. Good to see everyone here this morning in the main hall here out in the cafe, and those who are watching at home either today live or later on the week. If you're watching it later on the week, you can skip this part. It's probably the best to do. I'll just pray before we hand over to Rachel and Timmy for worship. Father, we just thank you that we can come here this morning, meet in this way. Although things are different, that it's good that we can be together. We just pray for today, just for what we hear today from Ricky. And we just pray that you'd bless us today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's sing that bit again.
Jesus, take me as I am. I can come no other way. Take me deeper into you. Thank you.
God, it is true that better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Forgive us, Lord, if we want to dwell there for a minute, out of the difficulties and strains of life. Forgive us, Lord, if we just want to sit in your presence for a bit. We need you, God. For as we sit in your presence, we then have the strength to carry on. We need a glimpse of you, God, to be able to move on and show your love to this world. Will you come and make your presence especially known to those who are struggling this morning? I know you love to have us sit in your presence. So when I ask for forgiveness, it's not ungiven, it's not required. It's that we know we must take strength from you and move back out to the world and show your love. Let's sing that Better Is One Day together again. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts. Thousands elsewhere. Better is one day.
Thank you. Welcome. It's good to be here with you. I'm just going to put my stopwatch on because my wife always tells me, you know how to talk, boy. So make sure and put your stopwatch on. I just want to welcome you this morning, whether you are here, whether you've come in since we did the original welcome, or you're here in the room, whether you're in the cafe, whether you're listening at home, whether you would say you have been part of the family here in Mountsandel for years, or whether you would say you've come as part of the journey in recent times, I just want to say it's so good to have you here. And I don't believe God works in coincidences. I believe that you're here for a reason. God wants to speak to you, and he wants you to be part of his ever-increasing kingdom-building work that's happening, not just with us, but across this area. So you're so welcome here this morning. I hope that your heart will be encouraged as you hear a little bit of what God's been up to. If you've come expecting to hear John Mark, I'm really sorry. I am not as concise a teacher. I am not as good at holding my emotions in. I use my hands quite a bit and I express myself like this. So I just apologize in advance. I just get passionate about what I'm speaking about. But I hope that that rubs off a little bit on you this morning. So I want to talk a little bit about this idea of being family on mission. For some of us, you will know what we're talking about on that because you've been part of the journey here the last few years. But instead of just standing here and giving you some sort of stodgy report and saying, hey, isn't it good what we're doing? Yeah, well done, all that sort of stuff. That's not how I like to do things. I love to tell the story of what God is unfolding in this area. And I want to invite you in to either see that story revived within you or to hear it for the first time and to come and be part of what God wants to do here in this area of Ireland. So family on mission, let me take you on the journey of where we've been so far. If you go back to late 2017, early 2018, as the leadership were meeting and discussing what God was laying on their heart, going into early 2018, there was a series called Listening to God. And at that time, the heart was, how do we, not just as leadership, pretend that we're the professionals and we only hear from God, but actually, what is it that God's saying to all of the family here, all of the church family, all of the fellowship here? And there was these things that began to unfurl at that time around seeing that strengthening of the family as we go deeper in our walk with God, but that would always widen out to allow others to feel welcome and seen and acknowledged as being loved by God, that the love that we feel and experience in our hearts as followers of Jesus would overflow into the lives of those around us. And so as that began to unfurl and we listened more to what it was that God was saying to people, give opportunities for feedback on that, there was this growing sense of the words family on mission. We are family together and we're on a mission to see the love and the hope of Jesus overflow into the homes and the hearts of those around us. And God began to identify just areas where his heart was already breaking for. This, I got to say, was not our idea. This has always been God's heart. He's just beautifully and humbly inviting us in to be part of that. And so the four areas, and this is not solely all about these areas. We want to see God move wherever. But these were areas that God seemed to be bringing an increased clarity around. So there was Mountsandel here. Let's not forget that God called us here to be a faithful witness and to love this community well. But almost, and it wasn't intended this way, I don't think anyway, by looking through the story, it's almost been like a Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and beyond. There's been the Jerusalem, the Mountsandel as such, and then the Heights area of Coleraine. And then as we move out, a little bit further, Port Stewart. And then as we look at beyond and right across into the south of this island, Sligo, that God was putting on our hearts. And so there's been a momentum that's been building up until last year where there was things beginning to happen there, increased clarity. And the leadership decided at that point that, because we all know the amazing job that JM does in helping to and teach us and lead us, but we cannot allow him to be distracted in that. So they decided they would appoint someone on a part-time basis to begin to just explore this a little bit more and bring us all on the journey with that. And hey, that's what I try and I'm trying to do. I want to say something to you. I don't have all the answers in this. I'm not an expert. Probably a lot of you are better at the things that we need to be doing. I just want to see those gifts, those passions that you have come to life. This is not about just me doing stuff, but all of us on this journey together. But then, of course, all the lockdowns and the restrictions came, and as I started the role in September, we thought things were beginning to reemerge a little bit, and boom, within 4 or 5 weeks, we were back to being restricted. And that sort of tells you where we've been in the last 12 months. I want to share this picture with you because this is, I believe, a significant picture that God shared with us at that time as we were beginning to prayer walk. This actually came out of some prayer walking that was happening in Port Stewart, but I think it's right across all of the areas. You see, what happens whenever we hit crisis points in life? Well, everyone will tell you there's only two options in that. You either fight or flight. When we fight, that means we try to push on through. It's all about effort and struggle, and it leads to frustration and anger. Doesn't sound like a good thing, does it? Or we flight, we stand back. We're full of doubt and fear and anxiety, and we say, did God really say this? How can we do this at the moment? And we hurtle in and sit back. I don't think either of those are good responses to crisis moments. I think God gives us a third one. Not fight or flight, but we face those crisis moments with faith, with trust in Him. And so, as we began to say, I guess, pray the prayer of Jehoshaphat, Lord, we don't know what to do, but our eyes are on You. This is one of the recurrent themes that seemed to come up. Was it, what if God has ring-fenced? We saw His construction site. He's ring-fenced, but the work is still happening behind the scenes. It takes trust to have to keep out and allow God to be God, hey? Because so often we want to get in the middle. What happens is the work either stops or we get hurt. How about we embrace God's sovereignty? Okay, You've restricted us. We're not happy with it, whatever your feelings are on it, but we trust You. And so this little picture was shared one of those mornings around, if you can see on it, there's like a protection around the tree. And what does that signify? Well, it allows the roots to grow deep. It gives the protection for the roots to grow deep. And what happens when the roots grow deep? The fruit is much more abundant. There's a far better harvest. There's a wider canopy for people to sit under that tree. Maybe that's what God's been inviting us into. But that doesn't mean you sit around and just allow God to do whatever. He's always inviting us to partner with Him. And so rather than overcomplicate things, we come back to the basics at that point of love God and love others. I'm talking to myself as much as to anyone else here, but why do we overcomplicate it and make it more complicated than that? Love God, love others. That's His command. That's His heart for us, that we would grow deep in our love for Him, that we would grow deep in our love for others, and we would see that overflow and spill out, not just inside one building, but into communities where He is already and where His heart is. We just need to catch up with Him. Let me share one more thing with you around that. See, what I sense God saying at that time to us, look, I'm not even going to be as arrogant to say that. I don't know if it was God or not. It might have been just my imagination. I don't know. This is what we kept sensing God was pressing us into. You see, it's okay to think that physical presence is the answer to everything. But you know, we can be physically present and not be faithfully present. Let me say that again. We can be physically present and not be faithfully present. What do I mean by that? Taking what this love God and love others. We can be present here in a building and not grow in our love for God. We can be present in a building and not grow in our love for others. Both not being faithfully present, physically, not faithfully. We can live in a community and have all these brilliant buzzwords about how the church is moving outside the building and God moves in the everyday. And we can be physically present there, but not faithfully present because we're not growing in our love for others and our love for God where we are every day. And so that's been the challenge in the last 8 months or so. I felt in the role. How do we be faithfully present in these areas? Even with the restrictions, how do we be faithfully present? Not trying to exceed God, not trying to go above Him, not trying to break the rules, but being present within those. And why is that important? Because no matter what the next 12 months, no matter what the next 2-3 years look like, if we can be faithfully present, it doesn't matter what comes our way. Because we can be faithfully present and love God and love others wherever we are if we just can grasp that. So what's it look like in those four areas? I'm not going to share everything. I just want to give you a heartbeat of what has been happening. So in Mountsandel, the area God called us to all those years ago, we've tried to just be that little bit more faithful in our presence with people. So going back to the word early in 2020 from the elders, from the leaders, there were two of them that shared around. They felt God was calling us into this generosity in the year. Generosity with their time, generosity with their faith, generosity with their finances. So it's like, hey, God's already spoken. Let's do that. So there's been moments where we've got to do that, where we've did some giveaways to the neighbors, where we've seen there are people in this community who are serving our community really well, and they're on our doorstep. The hospital, the nursing homes, the nurseries, the schools, the shops, the GP surgery, the physios around the corner. These are people who are in our community, loving people well. So how do we honor them? Just honor them with some little blessings. And what God's been doing is just continuing the connections. We have a beautiful thing in this center, an anchor point for the community, with a cafe that have people in it who are beautifully connecting with the community, loving the community, so much so that when we're chatting to people on their doorsteps as we did the little giveaways, that's what they're talking about. They miss being seen and being known and being loved and being acknowledged. So how do we take what was in our hand, a coffee shop, and be present with that? Well, the girls beautifully offered free tea and coffees on a Tuesday. Why? Just to unconditionally love a community. No agenda. And the agenda is love God, love others. Trying to live it out. There's been beautiful connections that have been ongoing with that. Even the community garden that's here. Seeing that schools are beginning to connect with that. With people who just want to love this community well. It's not overcomplicated. So what does that look like? In the Heights, what does that look like in the Heights? That's been strengthening the roots of what has already been going on there for the last 2 years. Alistair and the team are digging deeper, beautifully being present and serving a community, loving the community well. Seeing God work in people's lives. But strengthening the roots of that. Strengthening the core of what's been happening there, laying the foundations, has looked like consistently showing up even during the winter time when we can't do gardens. Little bags of blessing. Loving people well. Some people who are just spending time checking in with people. It's seen strengthening the roots of the friendship and the unity that there is with the other churches there and inviting other people from other churches onto the steering group or the committee of that. Why? Here's the reason. See, sometimes when we get caught up in these areas, we think this is all about some sort of church planting strategy. That's our way of trying to take control. In the Heights, let me make this really clear. There's doesn't seem like there's going to be a church there. That's not a church plant. That's us taking control. There are people already there who love that community, and we just want to get behind like the second row of a scrum and just say, hey, we are with you and we want to help love you well. A sense of unity and serving a community together, strengthening the roots of what God wants to do there. In Port Stewart, what does that look like? Being faithfully present. It's been a couple of couples who we've just, before the restrictions, we were able to meet together at home, take food together, get to know each other, build relationship, turn up and be present at community events like community litter picks and things like this. When the restrictions came, it's easy to step back, but we pushed on into that. Couldn't meet, but we could meet to take communion. We can set up a WhatsApp group, see how people are in need. And can I tell you something? We, as a family, have personally felt the love and the affection when people get around you and love you well. Learning to love our neighbours. Not just inviting them to events, but being present and walking through the pain with them. That's strengthening the roots of God's family. And I tell you these things not, I feel like I need to say it. This is not a, hey, we're doing so great. This is a, hey, God's starting to do something. Let's get on board with this. And then with Sligo, and I should have said in Port Stewart, there's a weekly prayer group that meets to prayer walk on a Wednesday morning. And particularly if you live in Port Stewart, I want to say to you, you're welcome to come to that, but anyone is welcome to come to that. Just let me know and we'll try and work that out as best we can within the restrictions. We've done that over the winter time. But God is meeting us. And see, this is where I get carried away. No notes or anything. But God's doing something in Port Stewart that is much bigger than our vision. He's calling people to there. He's bringing people to there. He's got a heart for there, much more than ours. Our role is to be present. Keep loving God. Keep loving others. Leave the rest to him. And then in Sligo, what's that looked like? Because I'd love to have been physically present there with them at times. But that's strengthened the roots again. Week after week, a Zoom prayer time where I've been invited into the family there. Getting to know the people, getting to know the needs, understanding that we are not some people who have all the answers coming to an area where we have to help. No, no, no. We come with a sense of, can we sit at your feet and serve and wash your feet and encourage and love you as best we can? And in all these things, the beautiful thing has been others are getting involved. There's been teams who have been out serving the community. There are teams of people who have been making up little hampers. There are teams of people out prayer walking in the Heights. That's another way that things have been strengthened in the Heights, regular prayer walking groups. And so I want to bring this into some sort of application for all of us, because it's nice to hear what God is doing. But the challenge for all of us is he wants you and I to play a part in all of this. So how can I be faithfully present? What I've done is I've given you, rather than me stand and talk about it, I've got some little cards. They're basically just little sheets of paper. And on one side of it, it says how to pray. Can I encourage us? One of the things we can do is begin to pray for these areas. There's some generic ways to pray around them. If you want to pray more specifically for these, can you contact me, particularly with, say, Sligo? Contact me and I'll give you some more deeper prayer requests that I just don't want to share around, because people are... I'm losing my train of thought again here. This is the problem as well. Sometimes we get up and we want to share these stories, but we forget that there are people behind the stories. And so if you're engaging with someone and they're trusting you with information, if they're trusting you with their heart, church, we have a responsibility to honor that. So not standing at the front and sharing people's deepest problems, but journeying with them in that. So we have some ongoing prayer requests and some ways for you to get involved in all of the areas. what I would say is, if you live, particularly if you live in one of those areas, if you live in Mountsandel, God has you there for a reason. If you live in the Heights or you've moved there recently, God has you there for a reason. If you live in Port Stewart or you've moved there recently, God has you there for a reason. And hey, be open. I think God wants some of us to go to Sligo at some stage. I don't know what for. I'm just putting that out there. God may be stirring your heart. If you live in those areas, get to know your neighbors. Love that community. Be present at events that are happening. If you live in this area, be part of the community team. If you live in the Heights, get involved in digging deeper. See Alistair. Be part of the prayer team. Maybe God's stirring ideas in your heart. If you live in Port Stewart, come and talk to myself or Tim or someone who lives there. And let's just begin to see what's been happening beautifully between a couple of couples. Spread out a little bit. Where we love one another. If you have stuff that God's put in your heart for Port Stewart, bring that to the table. Let's lay it on the altar. And hey, if you know anyone else that's pursuing God's heart for Port Stewart, get behind them and pray with them and champion them. This is not a competition. It's God's heart. And if you want to get involved in Sligo, maybe later in the year, if things allow, we might be able to take a little team down and pray and encourage and serve. I don't know. What I would say is, here's one simple little challenge. Grab one of these cards on your way out, okay? They're at the table here. That's how to pray, how to get involved. But I'd love to try and simplify things down even further. Because all of us, no matter where we live in one of those areas or not, all of us, there's a call to be faithfully present, to love God and to love others around us. And so often, I've done it myself. We walk inside our houses into our place of refuge. And we don't know what our neighbours are going through. We don't know what that lady across the street is going through, what that family are suffering with right now. We have the answer. His name's Jesus. He's told us to love his Father and to love others. So how about instead of just walking in through your door? And I know, I get it. It's really hard to do this at the moment, okay? But this is being faithfully present. Mark out a little card, 9 squares on it. This is not my idea, I have to say. This comes from a beautiful book called The Art of Neighboring. It says, love where you live. Put yourself at the center of that. And who are the 8 houses around you? Who are the 8 closest people to you? If you live out in the country by yourself, who are the 8 people that you seem to come into contact with most? Not your family. I mean, like work colleagues, the barista in the coffee shop, the delivery driver who's coming to your door. Here's the challenge. 3 things in each box. What's their name? It's pretty easy. Just say hello, what's your name? 2nd thing, something about them. Now, I don't mean something that you just know without having to talk to them, like he's a DVD driver, or they've got beautiful flowery curtains in their house, whatever. I mean, something that you have to engage with them a little bit. And then here's the 3rd, where I want to push in a little bit. Where's the needs in their life? And now, I don't mean, and if you're listening at home to this, and you don't, wouldn't say you're part of a church, I don't want you to think you're a project. No. You're a person who has value. And we just want to get alongside you to help you to realize that. We want to love you well. Sometimes we need a little bit of framework to help us in that. So who are the people beside you? Something about them. What are their needs? Some of you could fill this out already. Keep doing what you're doing. I want to learn from you. I find this a challenge. And I encourage us all to take this morning, just a little bit of a challenge. So as we go forward, the journey continues. God is consistently inviting us into his mission, not ours, his mission. Are you going to accept? Let's pray. Father, we thank you that it is your heart to love people well. It is your heart that has created them with a plan and a purpose and an identity that is found in you. And I thank you for the people in our lives who took time, as they love God, to love us, to love me, to love whoever. Would we take that as our foundation and build on that? That's our inheritance. People have done that in the past. And this is our generation. This is our time that you have us alive for. And we want to always love you. We always want to be able to gather and to praise you. But we realize that at times, I haven't done it as well outside this building. We maybe haven't been as faithfully present as we could be. So we need your help with that. So Father, would you fill us afresh with the love of Jesus? And you fill us afresh with the empowerment of your Holy Spirit, that we would follow the Jesus way, that we would live out his great commission, that we would follow his words to love the Father and to love others. So I pray for everyone here this morning. I thank you for them. I thank you that you have placed them in their homes, in their workplaces, in their families for a reason. That's who you are. You don't do things by chance. You're a sovereign God. And so would you awaken us to that so that we may be more intentional in our everyday. We thank you, Lord, for what you've been doing in the last few years. We thank you for what you've been doing in the last few months. But we offer that to you as our sacrifice. We don't need any plaudits. We just say thank you for inviting us to be part of that. Bless the communities that we've talked about. Lord, would the people there, your people, your creation, your loved ones, become so aware of your presence that it radically transforms their lives and the communities there. Not for our glory, but for yours. We love you. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
Savior and all but
So thanks to Ricky for what he shared. And just to lead us into communion, just as we think about what Jesus has done for us, what Ricky was saying was what we're trying to do is just to share the hope that we have and the hope that Jesus can offer for us. And just as we take communion, then we remember what Jesus has done for us, what he's done that's made it possible for us to have a relationship with him. I was quite happy, Paul, with your first choice of songs there, the Lion of Judah, because I thought it might have fitted in with what I was saying. But hopefully this will be okay. I think we're okay. We're on the same theme. Just Arthur just encouraged us lately there just about the importance of reading scripture. I'm just going to read the scripture here and not make any comment on it. And hopefully there'll be some words from what is read that will just that you can focus on as we remember Jesus this morning. I'm going to read Isaiah 53. I'm going to read the whole chapter. So it says, "Who has believed what he has heard from us, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of a dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and as for his generation, who considered that he was cut off out of the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. And they made his grave with the wicked, and with a rich man in his death, although he had done no violence, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him. He has put him to grief. When his soul makes an offering for guilt, he shall see his offspring. He shall prolong his days. The will of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Out of the anguish of his soul he shall see and be satisfied. By his knowledge shall the righteous one, my servant, make many to be accounted righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will divide him a portion with the many, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul to death, and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sin of many, and makes intercession for the transgressors." We'll just pray. Father, we just thank you for what you've done for us. We just thank you that the Lord Jesus was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. We just think of the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, that we might have that relationship with you, that we might be made perfect, Father, with you. We just thank you for what Jesus suffered and what Jesus went through, that no matter what we go through in our lives, that Jesus knows about it, and he can walk with us in that. We just thank you, God, for the bread and the wine that you've given us, just as a symbol of what Jesus has done. And we just pray that as we take it this morning, that we might be thankful from our hearts for the sacrifice and for the love that you have for us. Amen. So just before we have our open time, I'll just pray. But just before I pray, just to say that Simon and Tina Jennings have just had a baby girl called Isabel Benny Eve Jennings. So we just like to congratulate them on the birth of their daughter. And we just pray that everything will go well for them at this time. Just also wanted to say that Animate, the youth program that we have, is recommencing next Sunday. And if you have an interest in young people or a passion for young people or feel that you could help, we need a few other helpers, and if it's something you could feel that you could would like to be involved in after sitting in the house for months, there's an opportunity to get out on a Sunday evening and serve in that way with the young people. So if that's something you're would interest you, if you come and speak to me, or just maybe drop JM an email or something like that. We would be glad to have you as part of the team. So I'll just pray, and then after I pray, then we'll just say goodbye to those watching online, and then we'll have our open time. So if you have anything that you'd like to share with us, we just ask if you make your way up to the front here, just so everyone can hear. So we'll just pray. Father, just thank you for the time we've had today so far. We just think of our young people upstairs as well, just in adventures and creche, and we just pray for them, just for what they are learning and what they are doing. Father, just thank you for them. Just thank you for those who are teaching them today. Just pray that they'll be helped and blessed as they are there today. We just thank you for what Ricky has shared, and just thank you for these opportunities to serve you in these different areas, and just pray that what he has said today might stir up different things in our hearts, that we might look for opportunities among our neighbours to serve you and to show them the love of Jesus. We just thank you for the birth of this baby, Isabel. We just thank you for Simon and Tina and for Anchor, and just as this new life comes in to their lives, that you would be with them all and help them as the baby grows and develops. Father, we just thank you for this and for this miracle. We just would pray for each of us here today, and just for the different things that are going on in our lives, that you will be really near to us and help us. And we just ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So our time's open now for anyone. If you have anything you want to share, just make your way to the front.